angle or from your family angle, and all different angles. So I'm very excited to be able to talk to some of the people who really appreciate what we did. So I'm just going to give you a little background about myself. So I grew up in apartheid South Africa in the 1950s and 60s. And when I finished school, I had absolutely no idea of what was happening in my country. I didn't even know the word apartheid. It wasn't really used then. And that's how they were successful, in that they kept everyone completely ignorant about what was happening in South Africa. I had no black friends. I went to a white school. All my friends were white, and I knew nothing about this. To find out about my own country, I had to leave South Africa. So when I finished school, as many young people do, they take a gap year and travel around the world. And I traveled abroad, came to Europe, and then I started to see films and read books and have arguments with people about apartheid. And I didn't know what to say because I knew none of this stuff. People were telling me about my own country. So then I started reading up, and the more I read and the more I watched, the more angry I got that I'd been living this complete lie, and I knew nothing about my own country, about the situation there. So I returned to South Africa and went to university in the early 1970s, and I became an activist, met up with other people, shared my views. And then I met a fellow there, and the two of us felt we needed to do something about this situation. So we left South Africa in 1974 and traveled to London, where we connected up with the ANC, the African National Congress, which is the ruling party today in South Africa. But at that time, from 1960 until the release of Nelson Mandela in 1990, it was a banned organization. You were not allowed to belong to it. If you did anything in the name of this organization, you were a terrorist or a communist or just a very bad person, and you were not allowed to promote the aims of banned organization. But we went to London and we joined the ANC and said we wanted to go back. And they said, sure, we'll give you the training that you need, how to operate in the underground, how to produce underground literature, how to secure yourself, how to communicate securely, and so on and so forth. So we came back and ran this underground propaganda cell for nearly 3 years. And then in March 1978, the two of us got arrested, and I was sentenced to 12 years in prison, and we were sent to Pretoria Prison. So this is actually a documentary that was made of the escape, and so that's not really us, but this is us sitting in a room there producing. You can see our primitive Ronio printing machine, printing off leaflets, putting them in envelopes, posting them all over the show, and distributing them in various ways. This is actually a picture of our little factory that we had, that one in the middle with a curved wall. It was a caretaker's cottage in this big block of flats, and we rented that and had our equipment in there, and we were producing all these leaflets. We used a thing called a leaflet bomb. Now, it's not really a bomb. It was a very small explosive device like this. The little metal tube here, the platform on top, and you put your leaflets, the kitchen timer and a battery, and when the timer comes around and makes contact, and a teaspoon of gunpowder in there, and these leaflets would go bang. You'd have it hidden in a shopping bag like that, and you could simply drop it in the street somewhere with a big crowd of people, in the rubbish bin, and these things would be thrown like 50 meters up into the air and then rain down and people would pick them up. So it was very effective. A similar thing here, this is a huge parking garage in the middle of Cape Town. We created an exploding banner that unfurled right from the top all the way down to the bottom. So it was rolled up with thousands of leaflets and a little exploding release device. Then this thing was chained onto the bars there. This is a cop afterwards retrieving the banner. He's pulling it up like this. It was very difficult for them to do anything because we chained it on with big padlocks and noticed the explosive, don't touch, you know. And, anyway, so that thing exploded. All these leaflets went flying. And we had a few more leaflet bombs at the bottom, blasting these leaflets into the air. This is a kind of, this is just an example of one side of one of these leaflets. You can see the printing is not very good because it's just on one of these stencil machines. And that's the kind of stuff that we were saying. It was just things relevant to the time. The best part of it was whenever we did this, it got into the newspapers, so that was even more effective than the leaflet itself. This one is in Afrikaans for our Dutch friends here who can probably read that. So you can see it's had a big effect. Then, as I said, we carried on for nearly 3 years. Then eventually in March 1998, this is where I was living, and this was my bedroom here. The other guy was at his bedroom on that side. They surrounded this place, came in with the guns, and arrested us, took us away for interrogation.
1978.
1978. 78. Yeah, whoops. You see the date there, that's 3rd of March, that's the day after. This is the prison where they kept us. This was before our trial, so we're still awaiting trial prisoners. We're held for interrogation. They obviously couldn't let us go, and we were held in this block here, this terrible place, for about 3 months until our trial. And then we were heavily interrogated, held in solitary confinement. It was a very bad experience. But as we were awaiting trial prisoners and not sentenced prisoners, we were allowed to receive food parcels and books and so on. And we managed to smuggle in this book. I don't know if you're familiar with it. It's a very famous film that was made. Papillon was a French prisoner in the 1930s who was held on Devil's Island, which is off the coast of South America, French Guiana. And he was a serial escaper. But this was an amazing book. Gave us really a manual of escape. If you ever want to escape from prison, read that book. It tells you everything. So the main lesson that he told us was if you're going to escape, there's two phases. One is getting out of the prison, and the second phase is getting away from the prison. Now, if you don't have help, you've got to have money. So we took that very seriously and managed to smuggle in some money. And we smuggled in these cigar tubes and discarded the cigars and rolled up the money, wrapped in plastic inside the tube, and inserted that tube, you can use your own imagination where we inserted it, and kept it there for 3 months. So each of us had a certain amount of money in our bodies. Okay, so reading the book, as I said, there are two phases, getting out and getting away. To be able to get away without assistance, you need money. The other thing, of course, is when you're in prison, don't look as if you're about to escape, don't talk to anybody else about it. Appear to be resigned to your fate, just like very obedient, don't fight with the wardens, just look as if you're quite happy about being in prison. It can't be a part-time project, you've got to devote all your attention to it, 100%. 24 hours a day, you can't just do it occasionally, let's escape. You have to devote yourself to it totally. Avoid lucky breaks, so if the warden leaves the keys on the table there or the gate is left open by mistake, don't go because you haven't planned for it, you won't be ready. You'll still be in your prison uniform, you can't. Just don't take it. You've got to plan from beginning to end and it has to be meticulous. And when you're out, you've got to get away as quickly as possible. Don't just hang outside or say, there's a pub, let's go and have a drink or something. And don't go anywhere where your captors might expect you to go. Don't go back to the girlfriend or the family and ask for assistance. Of course, you can't look like an escaped convict. You've got to look like a civilian. And very importantly, don't leave any traces. Okay, these are just some pictures of the... this is during the trial. There's a court orderly showing all the envelopes that they intercepted. This tube that he's holding up is something we were experimenting with, a leaflet mortar. The idea was that you'd blast a thing into the air above a football stadium and then it would explode and all the leaflets would come out. But we never used it. But anyway, it was meant to kind of
something for the judges to show what bad guys we were. And then this is me some years later. That's the dock where we were sitting in the courtroom and looking down the stairs into the cells below. So anyway, we got, between the two of us, we got 20 years. There's me looking a whole lot younger. Again, this is in Afrikaans, so als je Nederlands spreekt, then you can probably read it. So this is the prison we ended up in. You can see it's sort of a very small prison. It was built in the 1960s, especially for white male political prisoners. Every racial group had its own, so there was a white male and a white female and a black male. Every racial group had their prison. And it was said to be a maximum security prison, but we showed them in the end and had zero security. It was a very small prison, but it was a prison within a prison complex. So even if you escaped from the prison, you were still in prison. As you can see, there were just three floors, a total of 52 cells, but only 10 were used for the political prisoners, and they were there. This floor here was the political prisoners' wing, and then the remainder was occasionally used for waiting trial prisoners. And this section along the bottom here is the admin section, where the officers have their offices. Okay, I'm just, this picture is taken from, go back, press the right button. Taken from that point, looking into this dark corner here, you can see, looking across the yard like that. And this lawn here is that dark bit there. And as I said, okay, let me just explain a bit more. There's a street outside here. All around here is prison complex. This is the ground floor. So the front door is there, so I only had one door to the entire prison. The door that you entered through, and you were only meant to go through that door again when you had served your sentence. So this whole section here on the left was the admin section. You can see gun room and visitors' waiting room, the captain's office, all the stuff for the warders there. And this wing here was our dining room, our storeroom, and a workshop where we had to work during the day, a carpentry workshop. In the middle, it was open. It was just a concrete surface. We used that for playing tennis, and a lawn on each side. And at the top here was a catwalk with an armed guard walking up and down all the time with a rifle. So the outer wall was solid. There were no windows, so you couldn't break through that. And even if you did, you just got into another prison. There was no option, no possibility of a tunnel or anything like that, because it was all concrete.
You considered that too, digging a tunnel or something?
Not really, because where do you hide all the dirt anyway? And they would see you because there's a guy there and there's waters everywhere. So that was clearly not going to work. There was a gate here, this yard gate, but that was a temporary structure leading in. They were rebuilding a prison next door here. But still, you were just, if you got out there, you're just in another prison. That didn't help much. The street over there, there was a gate. If you could get into the street through that gate, then you were in freedom. This is the floor above that. So this is our section here. So you can see this number 17 was my cell, which is that one there. Mm-hmm. And that stairway there is that stairway up there. So this was our section, just 10 cells, there were 10 prisoners. So that was our challenge. This is just a bigger view. There's the L-shaped building again, Century Post. There's the street. If you could get through that gate, you'd go down the street and then you were in freedom. So, but all, everything on the right is prison.
I'll ask you that question.
Yeah.
Did you do it alone or together with your friend?
Well, there were 10 of us. The plan kept changing.
Okay.
At one point, everybody, we wanted to clean the entire prison out. But then the security conditions kept changing, and in the end, there were just three of us who managed to get out. Okay. This is the cell. There's a plan, a drawing. So on the left, you can see the bed, and there's a hand basin there. There was a window looking out to the yard above the basin, a little window here, looking into the corridor, and then each cell had two doors. So an inner grill, which is a barred door, and a solid metal door on the outside. And they looked like this. This guy here is one of the guys I escaped with. But this is 30 years later. Nothing much has changed. The cell looks pretty much the same, same color scheme, except now they've got four people in that cell. When we were there, it was just one. But anyway, you can see there an inner grill, and here is a solid metal outer door. This glass window wasn't there, but I'll explain about that. So you can see there's two doors that close like that. And this lock you could get to because it was on the inside. So you can get to both sides of it. It was right there, this lock.
Did you know them? Because you're showing it now, and I saw.
Yeah, it was all in my head, and I drew it afterwards. So it's.
But you knew while you were inside how where all the doors were.
Well, not immediately, but I was there for a year and a half, so eventually you get to know everything, especially if you're studying it very carefully. So, I kept staring at this lock on the inside on the grill, and. Of course, we didn't have the dimensions of the key, but you could see which key they were using, because when they opened it up, you were supposed to be standing there at attention. So you could just watch them very carefully, what key they were using. So it was a key something like that. Now the question was how to get those dimensions. I mean, for you guys, this is all obvious stuff, but remember, we knew nothing about locks at all. All we knew was there was this thing called a lock, and you needed a key. So I started thinking about it, and then I realized that most of the dimensions of that key can be obtained from the lock itself and from the keyhole. So obviously the round part of the keyhole is the diameter of the shaft. The length of the shaft is clearly going to be the same as the width on the outside of the lock. Because this lock was right there, it was quite, you could see inside it. You could see the scrape marks where the key had been turning. So that's the bigger circle showing you there. And then if you just simply measure from the center point to there, you've got the absolute height of the key. So that was pretty obvious. And then just by taking an impression on the inside of the lock, you could get the shape of the awards. And obviously the width of the keyway. So all those dimensions were just there. I found this picture just to make it clear that sort of, I mean, ours weren't rusty like that one, but it shows you the diameter, which is the height of the head of the key. This is just my kitchen lock at home. I was just trying to show you how to measure the depth of the lock, get the width of it. Then a piece of paper through the like that, just to get the internal dimensions, put a knife in and you just rub it in there, then you get the shape of the keyway. You simply draw it on a piece of paper like that, and there you've got your dimensions. You can see the diameter of the keyhole, the length of the shaft, and you've from the scrape marks you've got the height, and from the inner width, you got the width of the lock, and because we could see there were five cuts in the key, you're obviously going to be at least five levers, or at most five levers. So you simply divide the width by five, so you've got then the width. so all you've got left really is two, three, and four. But because four is the same as two, you've only got two dimensions left. And because each cut was equal, you only really needed one dimension. You just need to estimate the depth of two. And then three is just going to be the same depth from three. I mean, three is going to be the same depth from two. So really, all you have to do is look at their keys and estimate how deep those cuts were. So we made an estimate of, I can't remember, it was 2 or 3 millimeters. And that's all you needed. Everything else was there. So how are we going to make this key? I suggested making it out of wood. Everybody said, no, this will never work. Wood is not strong enough. You watch the way those waters turn that key. You know, it's got to be really strong.
the key must, I mean the lock must have a lot of resistance inside, but I wasn't convinced. So I cut some bits of wood like this, first a square bit, and stuck the head in like that, a little mortise thing there, I mean a dovetail joint, glued it all in, and then cut the key.
What did you use to cut the wood?
I had a file, which we managed, as I said, we were working in a carpentry workshop. I managed to smuggle the file up. I'll show you how I did that. So I constructed that key, and the very first time I tried it, worked perfectly.
Nice.
I had to file it a little bit, like you guys were doing here last night. But you didn't need a magnifying glass. Wood is very, scrapes very easily and makes marks in it. So you just file it and then jiggle, jiggle, and eventually.
So you did impressioning perfect.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So there's. I recreated the keys. And those are the bits. So you start off with the square one, you first round the shaft, and then you cut the other bits and glue it all together. And. You pressed there, you got a beautiful key like that. And I've got it here.
The original. Is the original one?
No, it's not the original, I'm afraid. Got rid of those very quickly. You can see how big they were. Huge key. Oh,
okay. Can you pass it around?
Can you pass it around? Yes, somebody can take it up. And those were our tools, really. A file like that. I managed to get hold of one day some plumbers came and their blade broke and they lost this bit of hacksaw blade and we picked it up. And that was a fantastic tool. It's even better than the file because you could use it sideways, just like a file, or you could use it this way to cut. And then a ruler like that, the ruler needed to start at zero. Many rulers don't start at zero, there's a little gap, so they're no good. Sandpaper and wood glue, that was our kit. And then this is how we smuggled it up from the workshop. We were allowed to have these thermos flasks. There's an old one that you could unscrew the bottom, put all the stuff up there. The file I just kept in the hairs of my broom like that. I had a broom in your cell. And yeah, so this is back to the plan of the cell. So now we've got door one open. That was quite easy. That doesn't take you very far because you're still locked in. The problem is the keyhole is on the outside. So how do you open a solid metal door that has its key on the outside? I mean, if it was you guys and you had your full kit there, you could just drill a hole through from the inside. Clearly you couldn't do that in a prison. So how do you open a keyhole on the outside? So that one really had a stump, and we came up with all kinds of plans. There was a little gap under the door, and we thought maybe we could slide something through and have some pulleys. And through this window here, you could put your hand out, but you couldn't reach that far. You know, your hand could just come as far as the hinge. So we thought maybe, I don't know, some kind of pulley mechanism. And it took us a long time to work out. And eventually, I don't know why it's going to. Key two. I know. This is just to explain that key two, we did get to the outside of this lock because every Friday we were locked into the section with all the cells open in order to clean the place. And there were no guards in attendance. So we could do the same thing, measure the wards on the inside. And you can see it was key two. The outer door was very complicated. It was a very complicated warding system. So you might think, why didn't you just cut all of that away? Just have no ward, just make it in like that. But you can see here, this point is very weak because now you've cut away the strength, and this is wood, remember, has to work, and it's very, can break off very easily there. So we kept the wards. So the wards themselves actually added strength to the key because you're now fitting very tightly around that thing. If we just cut it away like that completely, actually, we tried that, it just weakened the key and it broke. So it needed the wards to get maximum strength.
So you broke the key off inside the lock?
During some of our tests, one of them did break, but we managed to get the stuff out again.
but we never managed to get the door open that way. So.
But at this time you were from the outside of the cell. You were from the outside.
On Fridays we were allowed on the outside of the cell.
And there were no guards there?
No, not in, we were supposed to be cleaning it, you see.
Ah, okay.
So we could just test. But that doesn't really help you, even if you can open it. How do you open it from the inside? Because you're locked in yourself. So it doesn't matter if you get it to work from the outside, it doesn't help you much. So that's the key there, that's what it looked like. I've got that here too, I'll pass it around.
One question.
Hmm?
What about your other mates? You wanted them or didn't want them to see what you were buying?
We were all of the same political persuasion, so everyone knew it. That's the only way this thing could happen in a normal prison. It would be very difficult to do this. We were all political prisoners, we all shared the same ideology. Everyone knew that, so quite easy from that perspective. So this is the solution we came up with. That you had your broomstick in your cell, you could just take the head off, and we mounted the key on a block like this. Or even better, like that.
Cool.
Wow, very cool.
And I've got it here as well. Bring my broomstick with me. You can see, you get that into the thing, simply crank around.
Nice.
And there it is. Pass that one around to you.
And then it won't be the light, and you just need to get out of one cell, and then you can.
Yeah, so really, I only needed one person to do this. But that might look easy, but we never managed to get the key to work by testing it from the outside, but we knew. We got the wards right, the height of it, we couldn't figure it out because we couldn't see the scrape marks. It was inside this metal door. So it took me actually 2 months to get this one to work properly. Every night spending hours just filing this thing, trying it, sometimes having to build it up with epoxy because you'd file too much and then you build it up again.
And you could only test it on the Friday?
This is at night, so you could do it right throughout the night. So I'd spend like hours trying. Get this thing to work. And it had to work perfectly. If it was metal and strong, then you could just force it. But this thing had to work very smoothly and slowly. So you couldn't just jiggle
so
it.
So you were testing this at night through the bars?
Yeah.
But then if it breaks off, you have a problem.
Yeah. That's why you have to be extremely careful. So you just had to feel it. And if there was any resistance, you just stop. File some more. So it took like 2 months, and then I handed this contraption over to the next guy to try it out, and he didn't know about locking, so he had to try it, and if it didn't work, we had several of these keys, so one night he would try one thing, and I'd modify the next one, and it would go like this. So it took like 3 or 4 months before we managed to get two cells open, because it's the thing with these keys, they work perfectly in one cell, but then in the next one it didn't work.
But you could go out at night and then try from the outside already, or?
Could have, but it was quite dangerous to do that.
Yeah.
Then eventually we came up with this idea. We thought, no, let's forget this. Only if one key works, then that's fine. That person can come out. So we made a wooden key like this. Sorry, a metal key. You can see two bits of wire soldered together. Then the top bit there, that bit was wood, but glued on with epoxy. But the metal came right to the end, so it was very strong. And then the shaft was also just glued on there with epoxy. And now we had a really strong key, so it didn't have to be that accurate. And that worked very well indeed.
And you mounted that on the broom handle? You mounted that on the broom handle?
No. So the first prisoner comes out using the broom handle system,
yeah.
And then he is out and he can unlock the next one. With this one. Because it was too much to get the broom handle thing to work with all of them, because it had to be wood.
Were all the doors the same?
They're all the same. The outer door used the same key, and then the inner door used the same key.
Okay. Were you using steel wire or copper wire or
crazy? Those bits were steel wire. We managed to find two bits. There wasn't much around, you know.
I just kept looking, eventually we'd find something. So just two bits of wire and then we sorted them. So after a year, we hadn't got terribly far. So there's door one, two, and we managed to open three, which was also the same as key number one. So, but we had made some progress. If you see the showers here, this round thing here represents the hot water cylinder. And there were inside little lockers that had a door on it. And one day we were showering and we noticed that the plumbers had been there to fix something and they'd left one of these doors open, they hadn't locked it again. So that night I came out of my cell, right out, went in there, unscrewed the entire lock, took it back to my cell, made a key for it, came out again a second time, bolted it back in, and now we had a key for that first one. And it was a very simple key, so then we were able to pick the second one, do the same thing, come out, take the lock, make a key, and put it back again in the next.
This is for door number three?
This is for the showers.
Oh, the showers.
And the reason why we wanted to get into those things was that there's an amazing hiding place in the corners here. Because after a year, we had a whole pile of clothing that we managed to get from the awaiting trial prisoners. They used to throw their clothes out when they left, and we'd pull it out of the bin, clean it, and sometimes sew it up, make it look good. So we had a whole pile of things. We had so many keys that we made, and all sorts of stuff, you know, which had to be hidden. But still, after a year, that's as far as we've got. So only three doors. And we could get out of our section. But we didn't really have a plan. All we knew is that if we could get out of ourselves, at least it was a starting point. So there's the yard. And all our thinking was focused on the yard because it seemed to be the only way out of this prison. Either through that yard gate, but then there was a huge unknown because you're getting into prison next door. There was a window period in the evening when there was no one on the sentry, on the sentry post, between 5 o'clock and 8 o'clock. So there was a few hours there. But then at night they put a dog in the yard, a wild dog. So that was a problem. Our one plan was that we thought we'd stay on our level and go all the way to the end there, come down those stairs into this smaller yard here, close that gate there, stop the dog getting in. There was this tiny little bit of wall here, just there, where you could possibly climb over the wall. It was high, it was like 8 meters. Maybe we could make something to throw it up there and get over. And once you're over there, then you're sort of in freedom. But it seemed very unlikely because there were also prisoners on this side who would have seen us and would have raised the alarm. We weren't sure about this dog. It may have been just barking and aroused everybody. We were locked into our cells at night at 4:30, so the entire day staff left, and a single night warder came on duty. So just one warder on duty at night, but he had nothing to do. Everybody was locked in their cells, and he was just there for like emergencies. We were kind of stuck, and we just never thought of the possibility of going through that admin section. I mean, it was just completely unthinkable because the guy is sitting in there and there's all these doors. So 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 7 doors. How do you open 7 doors that you've never seen? You don't know what keys they use. Solid metal doors, grills, all kinds of stuff. Some of them were electronic doors. It was just completely beyond us. But then as we became more adept at making keys, we started making keys for everything, just for the sake of making it, just learn how to pick locks. So here was a visitor's room here, made a key for that, made a key for there, made a key for this yard gate, where we saw which one they were using so we could get out there. The workshop lockers here, so we had access to all the tools. This little thing there is a security locker. It had all the files and all the security tools. We could come in through the storeroom here, through that door, and then there was an inner door here, which we could pick that was out of sight. So you could come into the workshop, get all the tools that you wanted, and then smuggle them back into your cell. So we had keys for anything that had a lock.
and made a key for it. And every time we made a key, it like expanded our ability to do things. So you wouldn't be thinking of something, and then you'd just say, well, let's make the key for it. And then suddenly all kinds of ideas sprung into your mind. Wow, we can do this now, we can do that. And we thought, well, why not just make a key for number four, the admin section. We're always walking past there. As it grew, so you could get all the dimensions. And so we thought, well, let's make that. And then we started studying the other keys. Occasionally prisoners were taken out through the front door to go and see a doctor or a dentist or something. And they were given instructions, try and see which key they used for them. And so we kind of built up a picture of what keys we used. And it turned out that five was the same as four. Number six was the most important door because it was a solid door. In the day, that was open. It was always locked back against the door, the wall. Seven, we didn't really know. Number eight was actually an electronic door. So if you could find out where the button for that was, then you're through it. Number nine was not a serious door, it was just something like that door down there. And 10, the front door, was also not really a prison door. It was made to look like a house. It was just a wooden door, the ordinary kind of mortise lock. So once you had that picture, then it didn't seem so bad, but still, how do you get in there with warders to go and test these locks? So this is, we're just going back to like the little mortise locks, we made little picks like this. Some of them are just two lever locks. You could open a thing like this, and once you open it, you've got access to the levers inside, and then you can make another key out of wood. Then, for those easy locks, we came up with this idea, again, from the bent wires. You have these different heads like this that you could just slide on, like that.
Cool.
Just pop those on, and then you have a whole range of these things, and then you just test them. And then you've got...
Nice.
Who was the locksmith?
I was the locksmith. You. Yeah. And you can see this key has no shaft, so... you've got no shafts, nothing has to be that accurate, so you can just push it in and feel your way around, and it worked beautifully, this thing. Mm. Then door four and five was just, again, all the major dimensions were obtainable from the lock, and just by looking at it, we could say, okay, the cuts are about a millimetre, very shallow cuts, and made it, and it just worked straight away. Door six, okay, let me explain how we got to this one. So then our plan was, let's, at night, this single night warder on duty, he came out at 8 o'clock, regularly 8 o'clock every night to do an inspection round of the prison. And it took him about 20 minutes. So we had a window period of 20 minutes that we could get out of ourselves, go downstairs while he's doing his tour around the prison, and test the next door. So that's what we did just shortly before 8 o'clock. We came out of ourselves, just two of us. I got a picture of, wanna go back? Yeah, go back here. So come out of ourselves, one, two, three. So I came out first with a crank, released the other guy who was in 23. And then we came out, went down those stairs, and where it says there, cupboard under stairs. So you come down the stairs, and then under the landing of the stairs was a small cupboard, so we made a key for that, and we could hide in there. And then at 8 o'clock, we could hear this guy coming out. He would come out of his office, walk down the corridor, through door four, go up the stairs right above our heads like this. And we had 20 minutes, so we opened, actually left number four open. We tested five with number four, and it worked straight away. Number six, we kind of assumed it might be the same as two because it was a solid door. We put our key in, and it turned, but it wouldn't open. So at least we were pretty sure it was two because it had that same complicated ward cutaway system. And that's what we had to do several times over. So like we went, did this for several nights in a row until we got six to work. Well, we never really got six to work until we created this one. because we knew the cuts were correct.
Didn't the ward notice that your cells were empty then?
No, no, we put dummies in our beds, and he didn't really look in the cells anyway. He just, he'd been doing it for 20 years. Nothing had ever happened, so he was
always the same.
No, sometimes, but there was mainly one guy. He liked being on night duty. And we always did it when he was on duty. So then we made this key, and that solved the problem. Because our overall dimensions must have been out slightly. The moment we made this, with no shaft, we just put it in open. And once beyond six, we knew that then we get beyond six and close it. Then we could tackle the rest of the doors without him seeing, even if he's in his office.
How did you come back?
No, I'll explain to you. So we locked in ourselves at 4:30. So at about 5 o'clock, one of the other prisoners climbed up on his cupboard and squirted some water on his light bulb, so the light bulb burst. And then he pressed the button for the warder to come bring him another light bulb. So while the warder's, so again we went down, hid in the cupboard. He comes up with a light bulb, and then they start chatting, you know, trying to detain him as long. He's very interested in talking about sport and all that, and keep him up there as long as possible. And then we slipped out through four, open five, open six, and once six was closed, then we had the rest of almost up until 8 o'clock, from 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock, mm-hmm. to work on the rest of the doors.
How could you? How could you hide this in your face that the guards were thinking you were imprisoned and you stay in your cell all the time?
Yeah.
And I guess you got the feeling of getting a little more free moving around so much. How could you
hide your excitement
about that.
That's what I said. We learned from Papillon is that you had to appear as if you were quite normal and.
One more question. Did you have watches? How did you know the time was so well?
Yeah, we didn't. We had. I haven't gone into all the detail. So from the time they locked us up until 8 o'clock, we were allowed to listen to music. And we had speakers in our cells, but the music was played by the warder in his office. So it was still the vinyls, you know, plastic records. And on the back of the sleeve is the timing of each thing. And he was always instructed to play the records in a certain order. So you could actually work out quite accurately how much time you had. But it wasn't that important, so long as we got down there to five, and we knew the sequence of the records, so when the last record came to an end, or when the last record started, you knew exactly how many minutes you had before you had to stop and go back. And then the music would stop like just before 8 o'clock, You can't see this very well, but this is from a documentary. It's showing now we're beyond door 6, and we get to door 7, so we had no idea about this, this one's key. But it was, the lock was there, so we just dismantled the whole lock. We made our own little spanners out of a piece of metal we found. And opened the lock and took all the levers out of it, made tracings of the levers, so that I could take those back to my cell, cut paper levers, and then make a paper key. So you get all the dimensions like that. And then with each of the levers, this is just my kitchen lock, and the prison locks were much more complicated than this because they turned twice. So there were two of these thingies, I don't know what you call them, gates or something. And then there was one on the bottom as well. It wasn't flat along the bottom like it is here. So each lever had four of those bumps on it. And then we filed them round like that and filed them down so that virtually any key would work in the lock. So I had to do that on 20 of those bumps in the one lock. And then we had to put it all back again, so the forensic guys must have had fun finding numbers on the actual levers and all the stuff filed away. So that got us through number seven.
But you have opened it first, before you make the modifications, or?
Yeah, well, when you've taken everything out, then you could open it, you know?
What was
the whole lock is
on the
same.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So we could get through there, and then lock door 8, as I said, was electronic. And we knew where the button was, so we pressed that in the office before we went through 6. So that was already open. Door 9, as I said, was just a wooden door like that, and we tried one of the many keys that we had, and we had that special thing with them, the different tops that you could put on, and one of them worked. So that was 9. And then 10 was the final door, but we dared not actually touch that because it was now getting towards 8 o'clock. The gates outside were locked. There was someone on duty. It was like you could see lights out there. And if we'd stood up, because there was a light inside the prison, they would have seen our shadows. So we couldn't really touch that door. And so I had to just lock it, assemble this lock again, close door 8, the electronic one. And then wait next to door 6 for the 8 o'clock inspection round. So we could actually look through the keyhole, you could see him going out for his inspection. Open 6, opened 5, locked them all again, ran back to the cupboard, waited in there for him to come down about 20 minutes, and he came down, and then we came up to ourselves. So that was it, and we figured out.
How many times have you been doing that, just walking around in the
Well, prison? To get to, okay, we only did one from 6, 7, 8, 9, we just did one, but to get 6 to work, I don't know, 5 or 6 times. So it was a lot, until we invented that key without the shaft, then it was easy. It was a strain on the nerves, as you can imagine, doing that kind of thing. But then on escape day, because we'd done everything, we were totally prepared, mentally prepared, completely relaxed, totally confident. We appeared casual and relaxed. All our equipment was ready, perfect, all our clothing. We knew exactly, we kind of worked it out in our minds, the escape so many times. We destroyed any evidence that could be used afterwards. So on the day of escape, we pre-washed all our clothes. Then we soaked our day clothes in the basin to deter dogs, you know, they could have given the clothing to dogs to find which way we'd gone. We'd changed the bedding, clothes in the bed, sprayed with deodorant, tried to make it smell something horrible so the dogs wouldn't know what to do. Pepper in the shoes, dummies in the bed, and the cells made to look as if we'd gone to bed. This is a photograph that appeared in the newspaper afterwards of what they found the next morning as the dummy. They pulled the bed clothes off and they found these dummies in the bed.
Sorry, the pepper in the shoes?
The pepper in the shoes because we assumed they would give it to dogs, you know, to smell.
Okay.
And then they'd be able to follow us. So it was just to put them off the trail. So we had sports shoes that we were allowed to use, which we used for the escape. So on the day of the escape, I came out first, I opened number 1 and 2, and I ran down, the next guy was an 18 and the other guy was a 23, so I opened them, all our stuff was ready in the hiding places there, we got dressed.
And you were 3, but the others did not want to go.
Yeah, the security kept changing and people just dropped out, and then some of them thought, well, I've only got a year to go, no point in doing this, and there was all kinds of political decision making and things, you know. Over here was an electricity switchboard for the entire prison. Also had a lock that we managed to pick that open. So the idea is we'd come out at about immediately after lockup at 4:30, open this thing, switch off the entire lights of the prison, go down the stairs and hide in the cupboard. So when the lights were off, of course, all the prisoners start shouting lights and pressing the buzzer and all that.
Mm.
So the guy comes up to look at what's the commotion. And the moment he walked over our heads, we came out. And we could do this very quickly because we had all the keys now. Key 7, we'd never tested, but now we had an idea because I'd made those cuttings of the levers, and the key worked perfectly, but then that's to be expected because we'd filed everything inside the lock anyway. So then we just zoomed down 3-4, 3-5, 3-6, 3-7, 3-8, 9.
Did you lock the door after yourself?
Mm-hmm.
Did you lock back after your...
We locked 6-7, but not 8 because that's the electronic one in case we had to go back. So we had built into our our plan the possibility of going back if something went wrong. So we get to 9, get to 10, and as I said, we'd never opened 10 before. How do you open this door? It didn't look serious lock. Just an ordinary mortise lock, like a house lock. But of course, we were very nervous and very impatient. We had a very small window, so it was about 5 o'clock when we got there. And at 6 o'clock, the gate was locked, and a guard came on duty. So we knew we had a little bit of time, an hour. So I started trying to pick this lock and brought out all the things, tried all the keys we had. But just nothing worked. Nothing worked. I suppose we were so nervous. Difficult to get a lock to work under those conditions. So in the end, we just decided to use the lock pick failure backup system. That is the actual chisel we used. I always kept it. I've been meaning to return it to them, but big screwdriver like that, and we just dug away where the bolt went into the frame. Behind the locking plate, just dug out the wood, and then managed to eventually break it open. That took almost half an hour to do that, it was making a terrible noise. But we did it. But we didn't want to break the prison, wanted to get out there without leaving a trace. But we got so far and just thought, to hell with it, let's just break this place. And we got out, and into the streets. I don't know if you can see here, there's the prison there, that little L-shaped thing. This is the dotted line that we followed. We crossed that main road, and we knew vaguely where the Pretoria station is there. You see the railway station. But we didn't know how to get there, really. And fortunately, there was a bridge right across here, across the railway line. It took us into the forecourt of the station, where we simply hopped into a taxi. We had all this money with us. And we asked the guy to take us to Johannesburg. This is how I looked on the day of the
sale. Yes, you would be very suspicious on the day to on the streets today.
So I kept all this clothing. This was all clothing that we got from these other prisoners who threw the stuff out. There's the chisel there, you can see. That's how I looked. Unfortunately, I don't have pictures of the others. Big news, three beautiful prisoners escape. So what happened the next morning was a little bit of a shock to them. Nobody suspected anything until the next morning when the day staff came on duty. And even then, apparently when the first guy came in, the front door was still sort of open a bit, because we couldn't close it because the bolt was still sticking out. He didn't even notice, just walked in, and the electronic door was hooked to that against the wall. It still didn't click. I suppose he thought someone is in there already in front of it. And nothing happened. So they come in at about 6, and then at 7 o'clock they unlock the prisoners. The guy just comes in, first cell, someone sleeping. Oh, occasionally that happened as someone overslept. Didn't worry, went to the second cell. Another person sleeping. And then he pulled the sheets back, and then all hell broke loose. You know? Yeah. So they were so embarrassed that they arrested that night warder, blamed everything on him. The poor guy had a hard time because they actually tortured him and forced him to make a statement. Because what else could they do? They couldn't say, because they couldn't figure out how we could have got out of their prison. It was supposed to be a maximum security prison, and three prisoners just walk out leaving a trace. So he got it in the net.
Mm.
Yeah, so the importance of money, we got out, had to buy, this is the actual little route map we bought. And I'll show you in the next picture, but that's just the inside showing the road, how to get to where we wanted to go. So this was our route, escape route. I don't know if this map means very much to you. Pretoria, Jan Smuts was the name of the airport in those days. We were hoping we could rent a car from the airport, but we didn't really have a driver's license at all. Maybe we could get a hire, somebody could drive it for us. But we couldn't, so we took the airport bus into Johannesburg, a train out to the next place called Springs, and then walked through the night to the next place called Devon. And if you look at the names of some of these places here, we've got Ermelo and we've got Amsterdam. You think we're back in the Netherlands. So we walked through the night, and then the next day we were able to pitch, because we knew we had a few hours before they would realize that we were gone. This shows the route on Google Maps. So if we had a car, it would take 4 hours and 42 minutes to the border of Swaziland here. And that route took us through Ermelo and Amsterdam. I've included this picture of this dusty African town. So this is the real Amsterdam, the one that you've named your famous city after. So we arrived here at about midnight, one on each side of the road, about 100 meters apart. Nothing happening in this town, a few dogs barking. Walked right through the night there, until we eventually came to this point here where the notice said the border post. And down the road we could actually see the searchlights of the border post. But we realized we'd not go down there. We can't go through a border, we've got no passports or anything. So we cut into this forest here, which is that point there. The previous picture is that point there. So we cut into the forest and walk down here in the forest, and here's the border. And we were expecting like barbed wire, maybe a no man's land with dogs and landmines and stuff, but it was nothing. Suddenly came the edge of the forest, the trees stopped. It was like a little stream there. We crossed over and climbed up the bank on the other side and came out of these homesteads here. And it was like very early in the morning, 6 o'clock, and there was a woman washing clothes in a basin. And my friend went up to her and said, "Excuse me, which country are we in?" This woman, surprised, an African woman, two white guys walk out of the forest, say, "Excuse me, which country are we in?" "No, you're in Swaziland."
Did you say two white guys?
Sorry?
You said two white guys.
Yeah,
it was three
two.
Of you?
Yeah, sorry, we split in Johannesburg. Oh. The other third guy had some contacts there,
okay.
And he went to them.
Okay.
So we crossed over here. This woman told us where we could get a taxi. We took a taxi all the way to the next place, which is called Mbabane, which is the capital of Swaziland.
How much money did you have?
I don't know how to express it, but probably equivalent of about 500 euros
okay. Today.
That was enough to get us by. We went there to Mbabane and the idea was to make contact with the ANC, but we didn't know how to do that. So we went to various places and said, "Do you know where the ANC is? Do you know where the officers are?"
White guys asking.
Yeah, white guys asking. No one had even heard of the ANC. So someone said, "What is it? What is this ANC thing?" So we're like explaining without saying it's like a banned organization. It's like, well, so she said, "Has that got something to do with refugees?" I said, yeah, refugees. "Oh, you must go to the United Nations High Commission for Refugees, just down the road." So we go there. I picked up a couple of newspapers. There's our mug shots right on the front page of the three prisoners escape. Went into this place and said, "Can we see someone? We're in trouble, you know?" I said, "Sure, just wait here." And this woman comes along. We threw the newspapers and said, "See those guys? That's us." Oh my God. And so we need to get in touch with the ANC. "Have you got anybody?" "Yes, you're very lucky. Lucky you came here and not somewhere else. I know just the guy." And she locked us in this room and we just thought, ooh, she could be the enemy, you know? We don't know.
Oh, yeah.
But in fact, she did. She connected us with the ANC. They came and collected us there. took us to the next place called Manzini, where we slept. We'd been walking for 2 days and two nights.
Yep. How safe was Swaziland in those days for you as an escaped South African
prisoner? Well, it was a separate country, but not terribly safe, because the South Africans used to regularly go in there and raid. They didn't worry about borders and things like that. Anyway, they took us, after we'd slept and cleaned up, to this place called Namache here, which is the border with Mozambique. But we had no passports, so this is the border control here. This side is Swaziland, that's Mozambique. So the guy just drove down this little road here, a little rough road, and explained to us, if we climb over here, go down here, and he'll go through the border and meet us on the other side. And that's exactly what we did. He just picked us up that side, drove us all the way to Maputo. Maputo is the capital of Mozambique. We were there for a short while, and then the ANC thought, no, this is still a bit too dangerous, we need to get you out of here. So they flew us to Luanda to get us really out of the way.
How did they fly?
I don't know. I mean, we went in a regular plane, I suppose they just brought us. Somehow they managed, we had no passports or anything. But no, it was a commercial plane, but we were the only passengers on it, so I don't know. Don't ask any questions. You see, they had very good connections there. So in Luanda, and then after we were in Luanda for a couple of weeks, they flew us to Lusaka, where we had a big press conference with the president of the ANC at that time, Oliver Tambo, and he announced to the press, I've got something to tell you, didn't say what it was, and all the press of the world were there, and said, here's you guys, they've escaped, and they're safe in the hand, and we made a press statement and all that, and the moment the press conference was over, they flew us out to Dar es Salaam, just to get us really out of the way. And there's the three of us in Dar es Salaam, freedom.
So the third, so the third joined you again. The third person had joined.
Yeah, he also managed to get out, but he had assistance. They took him out the same way, more or less, that we got out to Swaziland. But he was with the ANC right from South Africa.
So why did you follow your compatriot, the third person?
Well, we didn't know. You see, he claimed to have these friends because he'd lived in Johannesburg, and we didn't really want to just impose three people on this friend. It was too complex. And anyway, we just wanted to get out as quick as possible. So this is the poor warder who got arrested. He ended up being a prisoner in his own jail.
Really?
And he was there for 6 months awaiting trial. They wouldn't give him bail. These were pictures that were at his trial, just showing him. Here he is opening, I think that might be door four there. And eventually he got acquitted because he had made the statement and they could easily prove that was all nonsense. So he was. Well, the other prisoners, they moved them out of there immediately, put them in some horrible other prison. They spent millions rebuilding it. So this was the prison that was being constructed at the time we lived. Our beautiful prison yard was divided up into four like this. This was the post where the warder with the gun was walking, but they'd like to end up into a building. The front door you can see now opens up into the street, so you can't run out into the street and get away. But the basic structure, the L shape, is still there, you can see. This is from Google Maps. The guy who went back took these photographs, so what they've done now where that side window was, the window is still there, but they've put this over the top of it. Now you can't get your thing out anymore. And that's why they put a glass window here in the door so they can see in. So that's the prison, that's what it looked like. And there's me. Yeah, here's a document where you can download my book. I did write a book about it. You can download the entire book. There's a documentary made by National Geographic on YouTube. You can just type in my name, you'll find it. There's a second documentary that also tells a lot about the escape, but in it was more about a project that I got involved in the late 1980s, where in a sense we broke back into the prison. We created this amazing pre-internet communication system between South Africa via London down to Lusaka, where the ANC leadership was. And in the closing months of 1989, just before they released Nelson Mandela, the regime were talking to him in prison, discussing the terms of his release. And other business people were talking to the ANC in exile, and they were trying to create a rift between the two factions, between Mandela and the ANC. But little did they know that our internal communication system went right into Nelson Mandela's cell. And so Nelson Mandela was actually, through this encrypted pre-internet communication system, was actually constantly discussing what he was discussing with the government ministers, and this stuff was going backwards and forwards. And I had the grandstand position in London, I was reading all this stuff, amazing stuff, was going backwards and forwards. So in a sense, we broke back into the prison. And now they're making a major film about it. Daniel Radcliffe, he's the Harry Potter actor. So we'll have to wait for that. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.